And thanks to CCG for organizing this important conversation. I'm really delighted to be on the same panel as my dear friend, Excellency Ambassador Omar Samad, of course, Ejaz Heather and Joseph Mahoney and others. I think so much has already been said, and there's very little with which one can disagree. So I'll keep my initial intervention relatively short, and I'll be happy to jump in during the kind of question and answer session or the discussion. But I think three or four things that if you step back and try to develop a little bit more distance from what has happened, and it's still very fresh and raw, what has happened in Afghanistan. It was just on the 15th of August that we were all talking about, you know, we were still speculating as to what way things were going to go. And by the end of the day on the 16th or 17th, it was obvious that the Taliban were going to take over. It's only this week that we've had the UN Security Council and the US Treasury take decisions that will allow for humanitarian relief to get into Afghanistan without people needing to fear, you know, sanctions, bringing sanctions upon themselves for dealing with the Haqqani network or the Taliban, both of which are UNSC 1267 sanctioned entities. But I think, like I said, if we step back a little bit, there's three or four kind of big ticket questions that Afghanistan generates that we really have to take very seriously in the region that we're talking about. I think the first is this idea of modern warfare, and this goes directly to the heart of the argument or the debate or the discussion that myself and Ejaz Heather have had, but this is not a unique dichotomy of views among like-minded people. In the US, we had something called the right to, the responsibility to protect kind of mantra that came out of the Rwanda genocide and that was used in many instances to cite the need to initiate Chapter 7 and to intervene. So this idea of intervention as a principle espoused and agreed upon within the UN system, this really needs to be questioned given the record of these interventions. And I think the grand poobah in the hall of fame of these interventions is actually Afghanistan. So the idea was that modern warfare and the state in a box and the counterinsurgency doctrine and all of the, you know, these were little fads that came and went across two decades. And all of them were supposed to redefine modern warfare so that there was less blood and more peace as a result of it. And post-conflict state building was supposed to be five State Department briefcases, two NGOs, a couple of natives like me who spoke English very well and understood all the modern terminology of statecraft. And we were supposed to be able to put together a modern state. We've not just seen that fail in Afghanistan, of course, we've seen that fail in every single instance of global intervention. And I think that, you know, the tendency in certainly in Pakistan, I think maybe a little bit in China as well, which is understandable, is to point at the United States as the principal violator of some basic evidence when it comes to the results of intervention. But if you look at the intervention in Afghanistan, there was 48 countries that signed up to the military intervention. It wasn't just the US and the UK or just the English speaking world or just the Europeans. There was Turkey was part of it. There were Arab nations and GCC member states that were part of it. So this grand coalition that intervened in Afghanistan because of 9/11 had no plan as to what to do once they took out the Taliban. And for 20 years, the international order sustained this intervention. The record of this intervention is before us. The exact same people that were running Afghanistan on September 10th, 2001 are running Afghanistan today. And all of the state building exercise that took place, what is its status? I think that's a legitimate question. Now, the easy answer, of course, is that it's dissipated or evaporated. But I think there are elements of the intervention that do need to be identified and pointed at. So for my money, I think that the National Solidarity Program and the Ministry of Rural Affairs and Regional Development in Afghanistan, some of the IDLG stuff, the local government stuff, a lot of the girls' education stuff, and certainly the development of urban Afghanistan. Those are all things that we can point to and say, okay, in 20 years of intervention, these were some of the benefits that came about, and some of the voices of resistance to the rights violations that the Taliban are committed to. And I think this is also important. This idea of a Taliban 2.0 or a new and reformed Taliban is a fallacious one, because the Taliban is not a political movement. It is an ideological movement with a political arm. And that means that unless it is true to its ideology, it will not be the Taliban. So the Taliban are not reformed per se. They have not become human rights defenders, and they will never be. They are defenders and advocates of what they stand for, which is a very orthodox, and I would say extreme, interpretation of Islam, which is not followed by, I don't think, the majority of people in Afghanistan, and certainly not by the majority of Muslims all around the world. This kind of challenge is really secondary. I think the first point I had was about the international system and its failure. I think the second point is about state sovereignty. And this is a really critical point for people to remember for the region. State sovereignty, once compromised, is very much like Humpty Dumpty. It cannot be put together again. So if you try to draw the inferences or the derivative lessons from that, the one that screams out loudest to me is that the elites in this region have watched what has happened in Afghanistan, I think, very carefully. And so entrenched elites that are capable of drawing the right lessons will see that there is a regional and global interest in stability, number one. And if you look at, and this was a point that I think Professor Mahoney alluded to, and I think Umar Samad alluded to as well, the principal interest of the six neighboring countries or the wider region or the global community is that whatever happens in Afghanistan, the birth of another 9/11 should not. And counterterrorism is sacrosanct to China, to Pakistan, to Iran, to Tajikistan, to all of these countries. If that's the case, then we know for sure that our interest in the Afghan people is at best secondary. And I would say that's at best. But it is principally driven by the state interests of the countries that are looking at Afghanistan. This collective interest in stability can be a boon for entrenched elites if they play their cards right. But they must remember that the fate of the Ghani regime is the end result of an entrenched elite that fails to read the tea leaves and fails to act in a timely manner. So for me, while regional stability is sacrosanct for the region and for countries outside of Afghanistan, the lesson should be internal stability, that if you value the social and political construct that exists, where elite A or elite B or elite C is entrenched in power, then the interest that elite has in sustaining its own power should spur at least some reform. And I think this goes to a lot of what China in particular has tried to engage with, not just with Afghan elites, but I think with other countries too. And I certainly think that's the case with Pakistan. So I think lessons for the elite vis-a-vis state sovereignty are also, I think, quite important. And I think certainly for Pakistan, that holds true as it does for any other country. I think the third one is rather controversial, but I think this is an idea that many of us have discussed a lot more in private than we do in public here in Pakistan. But I think specific to Pakistan, one of the things that we should draw from what has happened in Afghanistan and what this all means for Pakistan is that, in my view, tentatively, and this is still I'm open to being challenged on this. In my view, it is Afghanistan and not India that is the defining theme for Pakistani national security. Now, this is a very major shift that I'm proposing has already happened. And I think there's some evidence to back up this idea or this notion. If you look at the kind of regime in Pakistan that has emerged, if you look at the emergence of a new national security discourse, including a formal national security policy that was approved just yesterday, but for a longer period of time, a discussion about what constitutes national security in Pakistan. The repeated emphasis is on geoeconomics rather than geopolitics or grand strategy. And I think that this indicates a certain shift in the mindset of the Pakistani elite, particularly the Pakistani military elite, but also the non-military elite. So when we think of the key divisions in Pakistan, of course, we think of civilian and military, and we think of extremist and non-extremist, and we think of urban and rural. But I think the most fundamental one might be the traditional elite and the emerging elite. And there's three facets of the emerging elite that are important, and they relate very, I think, very directly with Afghanistan. The first is that the emerging elite are, as I said, more likely to be urban than they are rural. The second is that there are more likely to be more females within this elite than there have ever been in Pakistan before. And the third is that they are more likely to speak Pashto than ever before. There's a final facet that connects this emerging elite in Pakistan to Afghanistan, and that is the demographic reality of Pakistan. The three countries that I think are most important in this region are Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Tajikistan. And the median age in these three countries, the highest median age is Pakistan's, and that too is below 23. Now, just for comparison's sake, if I'm not mistaken, the median age in China is above 37. These are not small differences. Even in Uzbekistan, the median age is above 30. So in Pakistan, the median age is 23. In Tajikistan, it's 22 and a half. And in Afghanistan, it's 18 and a half. What that means is that the next 20 or 30 years, these three countries, as opposed to other countries in the region. So again, to give another example, India's is, I believe it's 28, right? So it's still a young country. But the difference between Pakistan and India in terms of demographics, or the difference between Afghanistan and India in terms of demographic, is a huge difference. That 10-year difference when it comes to median age and what it means for the demographic curve, what it means for where these countries will be in the year 2040 or 2050, it's a massive difference. And what it actually means is that all of the conversations we're having today and what those conversations mean for those countries are fundamentally different, because the challenges these countries will be facing in a decade and a half and two decades are going to be foundationally different. Which brings us back to the idea of this new national security thinking in Pakistan. Yeah. If the Pakistani elite, I know that we're running short of time. I'm just going to wrap up in less than 30 seconds.
Thank you.
I just think that if the Pakistani elite succeeds in successfully shifting the center of gravity of Pakistani strategy from security to economics, it will be to the benefit not just of Pakistan, but of the entire region. But if it doesn't, then the cost will be paid not just by the people of Pakistan, but by the whole region. Thank you.
Thank you.